something in his appearance that we should have desired. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised. And we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down. be known as the Lord's forever.
That they shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often left there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus."
Said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let the
slave's name was Malchus, Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of the soldiers, the tribune, and the guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the crowds that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and the other disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter,
"Hanging yourselves and charging according to your law."
that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him, Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
have no power over me if it had not been given.
in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Kabbalah. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the crowd, they cried out, since it was the preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath of the day of the week was a solemn one, the religious leaders asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken. to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened, so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled, not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the religious leaders, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus, bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there, because the Jewish preparation day for the tomb was close by.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O God, and may I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We focus in great detail upon a death today. Never a subject that one enjoys. What is it about this death that stands out? So far, everyone who has ever lived on this planet has died. Some have had peaceful deaths at an old age, surrounded lovingly by families. So many others have died of violence, in war, in famine, in disaster, in accident, in unrelieved pain. It is the story of all of us that the bodies in which we are end, whether we are rich or poor, powerful or insignificant, famous or unheard of, talented or not so talented. Any of the things that mark us out stop at that moment of mortality. But we focus especially on the death of Jesus. What is going on here? I find it helpful to switch into psychology and family therapy for a moment. In family therapy, there is a concept called the identified patient. The identified patient is the reason people go to see the psychologist or the social worker or the counselor. The identified patient is the problem, often here, the rebellious teenage child or the alcoholic mother or somebody else. But what becomes clear is that the entire system is sick. That the identified patient is the tip of the iceberg. And in fact, that the identified patient, through their bad behaviors, is often carrying the pain of the rest of the system. Sound familiar? It was our iniquities he bore. He was crucified for our transactions. I'll give you an example. M. Scott Peck, the great Christian psychiatrist, wrote a book called People of the Lie. It was an attempt to understand the psychology of human evil. And he took stories from his own psychiatric work and changed them enough so that people wouldn't be recognized. And one has haunted me ever since I read it. It was about a teenage boy, about 15 years old,
who had been committing acts of delinquency, including trying to steal a car, and was locked in the psychiatric hospital, and Dr. Peck went to meet with him and said, so tell me about your life. And he said, well, I'm kind of a bad kid. My parents love me. I try to do it, but I'm always letting them down. And then they get talking some more. And one of the things that came out was that this boy's older brother had died by suicide not long before. And things got dark, and so Dr. Peck started to change the subject. He said, so what did you get for Christmas this year? And the boy said, a gun. He said, is that what you asked for? He said, no, I asked for a tennis racket. He said, what kind of gun? And he described it. And Dr. Peck said, that's the same kind of gun your brother used to kill himself. And he said, no, it was the gun. The parents had given him his brother's suicide weapon as a Christmas present. The boy was not a bad kid, but he would rather have been a bad kid than face the knowledge of how he was not loved, and in fact hated. And the parents, when confronted, say, we're not sophisticated like you. We can't be expected to understand that. What boy doesn't want a gun? It was an example of what he calls this evil. Evil often comes in respectable forms. Evil gets up every morning, takes a shower, goes to work from 9 to 5, and comes home, often not breaking any law. Sometimes evil goes to church on Sunday. Sometimes evil does everything outwardly respectably, but quietly poisons what's around it. We cannot ignore the reality of evil in the world. It is far too palpable. Just open a newspaper, turn on your TV, go to your social media site, see what's going on. Hatred and envy and violence and misunderstanding and suspicion and paranoia and nastiness. There's a pain that comes through all of it that we feel. And when one person gets put out as the sick one, often they are simply the identified patient. They're the ones that we're told to look at, but they're carrying the rest of it. So what does this have to do with Jesus of Nazareth? It says in Isaiah, God was pleased to crush him in infirmity. What kind of a God would be pleased to crush someone in infirmity? What kind of God would be pleased to put someone in pain? Obviously, it doesn't mean that. And yet, it says God was pleased. It was God's will somehow to do this. And in Hebrews, it says Jesus cried with God who could save him and was heard for his reverence. But son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. Jesus entered in. Jesus went beyond being the identified patient of the world, where all our sins and transgressions flow onto him. Because if that was all it was, he would have been just one more. How many people who are executed or imprisoned are really identified patients of a sick society? How many kids called delinquents are really identified patients of sick families? Sometimes the sickness is not where we point, but at the ones pointing, who are pounding it out onto someone else. But Jesus chose it. Jesus opened himself to it. He made himself vulnerable. He will live because he did this out of love for what was no longer lovable. A few years ago, a wonderful movie came out, powerful and difficult to watch, called Beautiful Boy, A Beautiful Boy. It was starred Timothy Chalamet and Steve Carell as father and son. And Timothy Chalamet's character is a very nice, sweet kid, but he starts with what often teenagers do, experimenting with drugs, but eventually goes down a very dark path and becomes so addicted that they can't have him in the house. When he's there, he steals from the family. They can't trust him. He's not reachable. Anything that made him attractive or charming is gone. And so the father keeps looking for him. We often have the cross explained to us in terms of atonement theory and satisfaction. And they're not necessarily wrong, but they miss it. It sounds, the way you may have heard it was, human beings sinned. And sinning against God is infinite, so only an infinite sacrifice could take care of it, and someone's going to pay. So God sent his only son to pay, because we couldn't. And that'll be preached across town and a few other places around here. And it's not technically wrong, but it's really misleading. Because it sounds like God is a monster who needs blood to be sated after being offended. That's not what's happening. God's love is more like that of the father portrayed by Steve Carell in Beautiful Boy. God's love says, I'm going to find out where you're lost, and I'm going to follow you there, and if I have to suffer for it, I will, but I am not leaving you. In Jesus Christ, God followed us not only into our lostness, but into our badness, the part of you or me that chooses evil, that becomes quietly toxic while maybe being outwardly respectable. God was in Christ reconciling us to himself. He was lifted up because this was for us to see what sin had done to the good one, the perfect one, the incarnate Son of God. To look upon this and understand the depth of love that would follow us not only when we were lost, but when there was nothing lovable left in us. Adam and Eve grabbed for things. Jesus Christ let go of them. He follows us into the way to divinity by surrendering everything, including comfort, including life itself. Not as victim, but out of love. And that is why the Gospel of John says he was lifted up. And that is why at the end, Jesus says, it is finished. And before it is finished, he says, I thirst. Doubtless he was physically thirsty on the cross, but he thirsted for the souls of those who were lost. To be saved, just as he asked the Samaritan woman at the well for a drink. Give me something to drink, I'm thirsty. I thirst, and then it is finished. And then it says, he gave up the ghost, was the old translation. He handed over the spirit. But the idea is that his spirit went out of him and went into us, bringing new birth, new hope. Possibility of life despite all the lostness and tragedy and evil we find in the world in which we live and we find in ourselves. If there were no resurrection, Jesus is one more failed idealist done in by corrupt systems of religion and politics. But we reflect on the quality with which Jesus dies, lifted up, completing a mission, giving over the Spirit. And that gives us hope to wait for the revelation that he is alive and that his spirit breathes in us with new and eternal life. Amen.
Increase it in love and preserve it in peace.
let us kneel in silent prayer.
Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you. Through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Arise. Let us pray for the Jewish people who possess an eternal covenant with the Lord, who delivered them from bondage to freedom, for continued faithfulness to God's covenant with them, for their flourishing in peace as witnesses to God's sustaining love, for safety from all malice and harm, for the fullness of redemption for the sake of God's name, that unity and concord may exist between Israel and the Church, Jews and Gentiles, in obedience to God's will. Let us kneel in silent prayer.
God of Abraham, you planted your people Israel at the root and grafted us as wild branches into a single olive tree of praise to you. As we come here to the cross, we lament the history of prejudice and violence we have fomented between ourselves and your faithful people, of whom Jesus was born. Bless the children of your covenant, Jew and Gentile alike, as we strive together to obtain the fullness of your blessing for the world.
Kneel in silent prayer.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer.
one through whom all things were